our clinic, what further history would be helpful to delineate this or narrow down the differential diagnosis here? I'd like to start with Dr. S. Sridhar.
Thank you. This is a case where, where there is low TSH with normal T3 and T4. So obviously the first thing we have to ask is whether there is history of taking thyroxine in this patient. And if he is taking thyroxine, the dose seems to be a little excessive. That's the most obvious thing to ask. In addition, sometimes certain drugs like glucocorticoids, dopamine, etc., can also cause low T3, low TSH. And it's also known in pregnancy also that there is a chance of a low TSH in the first trimester. That is also possible. And of course, there are certain non-thyroid illnesses which can lead to low TSH. And sometimes some psychiatric illnesses also present with the low TSH with normal T3, T4. So my history would be to ascertain if any of these causes are there in this particular individual.
Thank you, sir. As we can see, a lot of the differential diagnosis we can narrow down just from the history. There are many, including the drug history, any recent illnesses which have contributed what we usually call as a sick euthyroidism, now called as a non-thyroidal illness. If we move on, what clinical findings would help to further narrow down the diagnosis? I would like to ask the next.
I think first of all, we have to understand this is, as the case shown, is subclinical hyperthyroidism. So first of all, TSH should be 0.1 or low. If you are saying 0.1 or more, more can be 5, more can be 6, more can be 7. So the correct should be TSH 0.1 or low. Now the second issue is whether really this is a correct terminology or not. Subclinical hyper or subclinical hypo means clinically patient is asymptomatic and this is a biochemical abnormality. And here we are discussing that patient has some clinical features because of which actually he was investigated and a biochemical abnormality has been found. So to me, actually both these terms, subclinical hyper as well as subclinical hypothyroidism, is a misnomer because these are not subclinical. Patient has come to you with some symptoms and signs and then T3, T4 are within normal range. Only TSH is either suppressed or marginally elevated in case of subclinical hypothyroidism. And we must understand there is a hypothalamo-pituitary axis which is governing thyroid gland, which varies from person to person and in different races. So when we are defining the low, normal or high upper range of TSH, it is variable. For example, it is not uncommon in elderly population to find out a TSH of 5 or 5.5, which is higher than the normal. And we see a lot of our colleagues are treating such patients. But if you go into the research, there is very good publications in JCM where it has been shown that after 6 decades of life, in 7th decade and 8th decade, up to TSH of 8 is normal. So there is no point in treating such patient. Similarly, in elderly individual, as high as 10 to 15% of the cases have some transient suppression of TSH because of so many reasons. So a single finding of TSH does not qualify that this patient should be treated first. So this needs to be confirmed and this needs to be looked into the background of patient symptomology and patient comorbid conditions. So like in this case, if we are suspecting subclinical hyperthyroidism, patient needs to be examined. In history, an important historical event is any past recent history of sore throat or pain in the neck. If that history is coming forward, then this might be a case of thyroiditis which might be resolving and patient does not need anything. Then clinical examination, we need to examine the neck to find out what type of goiter it is, whether it is a diffuse enlargement, whether there is a nodule which is palpable, whether they are multinodular which are again is a pointer. Then we have to examine whether patient pulse, which is most important, what is underlying cardiac status. When we are going to discuss in this case, when we are going to decide whether such patients needs treatment or not, what is their underlying cardiac status at the age of 70 or 65 years of age. So if they have a cardiac disease, treatment options are different. If there is no cardiac disease, treatment options are again different. And I actually put down question mark because most of the time we refer to Western guidelines or Caucasian guidelines, because in our country hardly we have good prospective randomized controlled trial to prove out all these things. But in our country, we know every disease starts at least a decade earlier as compared to our Western counterparts. So if we see a patient of 65 years of age or 70 years of age, even without history, I do not think anybody can say he will have absolutely normal coronary artery disease. So this discussion is, I think, going to come up, sure, how to treat such type of patients. So that is another important scenario. So all these things needs to be considered in clinical background when we are seeing such type of patients. And we have to keep in mind what we are treating, what is our aim, what are the normative data for that age group of population. It is not that we are applying the normative data of 30 or 40 year of age to 80 year of population.
Sure. Thank you for that answer, sir. Just for the clarity sake, thanks for raising this point. The topic TSH 0.1 and more, actually from the organizers, it did not mean TSH above 0.1. More means like taking the discussion forward for wider audience. So just for the clarity, so that the audience are also clear when we go ahead. So as sir rightly said, the cardiovascular stator, goiter, everything need to be examined to see whether the patient is clinically thyrotoxic with that of TSH 0.1 and the T4, T3 being normal. The biochemical diagnosis, as the panelists have said, is a subclinical hyperthyroidism, which I also agree, think it's a slightly misnomer, because the patients do often come with some symptoms. On further exploration, they do have some symptoms in this context. And the differential diagnosis, Dr. S. Sridhar has elucidated to already, giving a long list of differential diagnoses, which we again see. When we do get patients like this, where the TSH is low, 0.1, T4, T3 is normal, very non-specific signum in a 70-year-old, tiredness, lethargy can be due to a multitude of other causes, including the heat and other reasons. So do we need to actually retest these people? Should we recheck the thyroid functions again? If so, when should we recheck, assuming that this is not a patient who has got thyroiditis?
Yeah, the patient really, I mean, it's an old man with a subclinical hyperthyroidism. There are, I mean, Dr. Sridhar was telling about various condition which is temporary. So the thyroid hyperthyroidism phase of thyroiditis can be, it's a very temporary phenomenon. Then we can retest around 2 to 3 months. We can wait and retest. But the patient has some complications, or has a cardiac problem, or a atrial fibrillation, or a cardiac problem, then we have to treat. Or we can wait. Or we can, the patient is having a risk for development of fracture, then the chance of development of treatment is necessary. Or we can wait for 2 or 3 months to find out whether the patient is recovering or becoming, the TSH is becoming normal.
Sure. Please.
Actually, the issue of retest comes when we are looking at TSH level. If your TSH levels are less than 0.01, it is very unlikely that these patients are going into spontaneous remission. It is only patients with TSH between 0.5 and 0.1. 0.5 we take usually as a lower limit of normal. Some labs use 0.4. So 0.5 to 0.1, if TSH is between this range, this is a type of patients which on actually routine testing, a good number of them actually are going to have a normalization of TSH.
Correct.
But if we are really seeing a patient with a TSH of less than 0.1, as he has pointed out, it is highly unlikely that they are going to have a normalization of TSH. And usually such severity is again not seen in transient conditions or drug-induced suppression of TSH, like dopamine or glucocorticoid or non-thyroidal illness, whatever we talk of. And then obviously we have to decide about the treatment.
According to one study, between TSH 0.1 to 0.5, nearly 30% of them normalize spontaneously without need of any treatment.
So the message from the panelists is that it really depends on the severity of the TSH suppression. When it is mild, between TSH of 0.1 to 0.5, some of them or many of them would recover back to a normal range. So at the time of assessment, when they are presenting to you, if there are no clinical symptoms suggestive of any features of hyperthyroidism or other risk factors like cardiovascular, etc., these population need to be retested after 2 to 3 months time period. So based on that, we classify them either as a transient subclinical hyperthyroidism, which can be due to various reasons. For example, in a patient who has had Graves' disease, where the TSH is already suppressed and the T4, T3 was elevated, you are treating them with either antithyroid medication or radioiodine treatment, the first change that you see is the T4, T3 comes back to normal. The TSH could well be suppressed for a long duration of time period, even up to 4 to 5 months time period before the TSH starts becoming normal. So if this were to be a patient who has got a frank Graves disease and on antithyroid medication or had a radioiodine therapy, he can present with a similar picture where the T4, T3 has become normal, but the TSH is just coming up. So this is a case of transient subclinical hyperthyroidism, or patients, as sir earlier said, where they had subacute thyroiditis due to viral illness or other reasons. In this scenario also, the patients might develop a slightly high normal T4, T3, maybe still within the normal range, but the TSH could be well suppressed. And then when during the recovery time period, they may have a picture where the TSH is low and the T4, T3 is elevated. So if the clinical picture is not suggestive of any of these things, then we need to define whether these patients are under the category of a persistent subclinical hyperthyroidism. And I'm sure most of us would have seen in our practice, a gentleman in this age group, 70 odd year old, coming in with a slightly low TSH, especially if they have other features like a mild goiter, because the most common reason why they present with a subclinical, persistent subclinical hyperthyroidism is a multinodular goiter with mild thyrotoxic picture. So the top of the list here says Graves' disease, toxic adenoma, and multinodular goiter being the endogenous causes for subclinical hyperthyroidism. But in this age group of 70-year-old, most often we see a multinodular goiter with mild thyrotoxic picture. Then comes your Graves' disease or toxic adenoma. Graves' disease generally manifests itself. The T4, T3 doesn't remain normal like this. It just generally progresses. On retesting, the T4, T3 starts going up. Sometimes we do see this in patients who have Graves' disease when they fully cured, but when they come back with recurrence, the first sign could be just the TSH getting suppressed. Then as you follow them through, the T4, T3 starts going up. And also, as we earlier saw, the exogenous causes first need to be ruled out from the history, that there is no exogenous ingestion of thyroxine, which is causing the suppression. Let's say a patient decides to take thyroxine from outside for whatever reason. The T4, T3 goes up, the TSH comes down. A week before they come to your clinic, they stop taking the T4, T3. Then the TSH could well be suppressed, because as I said, the TSH does take some time for it to recover, but the T4, T3 could be well normal. So these are the various scenarios we need to keep in mind when we talk about a subclinical hyperthyroidism picture. But apart from that, there are also other reasons for a low serum TSH with a normal T4 and T3, which are not actually subclinical hyperthyroidism. For example, a man who has got a pituitary deficiency, the TSH could be low and the T4, T3 either can be normal or it could be low. Some psychiatric illnesses, drugs, as he said, steroids, non-thyroid illnesses, previously called sick euthyroidism, late first trimester of pregnancy. As we know, the HCG shares one of the receptors with the TSH, LH, FSH, HCG, and TSH. Therefore, when the HCG level goes up during the early trimester of pregnancy, it can cross-react with the TSH receptor. Therefore, the TSH level can go low and the T4, T3 can go high. Especially this happens in patients with hyperemesis gravidarum, what we call as gestational hyperthyroidism. There are also some racial differences, like for example, in certain races like black individuals, the TSH can be low persistently for no reason. They could be clinically well normal, and smoking apparently has been shown to have a similar picture of a slightly lowish TSH. So we can see that the list of differential diagnoses is long. Taking a good history and a good clinical examination will narrow this down. And when we look into a persistent subclinical hyperthyroidism, then the discussion begins whom to treat and how to treat these individuals. So our patient did not have any of these features. He did not have any recent fever, URTI, illnesses, no thyrotoxic symptoms at all, no exogenous ingestions, and no symptoms suggestive of pituitary hormone deficiencies. Clinically, he had no goiter. The cardiovascular system examination was normal. He was in sinus rhythm, and there was no bony pain, no tenderness, no history of fractures, nothing at all. And this is also not an uncommon scenario that we come across, that the patient gets an incidentally low TSH, clinically being completely normal. So this gentleman had two sets of thyroid functions which were very similar, with a low TSH and T4, T3 being within the normal range, satisfying the criteria of a persistent subclinical hyperthyroidism. So the question to the panel is, how common is that we come across this in our patients, a picture of persistent subclinical hyperthyroidism?
Thank you. Generally, the approximate prevalence of subclinical compared to overt hyperthyroidism slightly up, around 2 to 7%, according to my research. But again, first of all, we should be clear about why we are testing thyroid function in this cohort of patients. In general, like pregnancy period, elderly patients, the TSH levels normally shift up. So in those population, if the TSH is suppressed, definitely that needs reviewing. And as we said, once we have established it's a persistent subclinical hyperthyroidism, then we can wait if there's no other comorbidities. But general, for direct question, answer for this is it's comparatively more common than overt hyperthyroidism.
Okay, so that leads on to the next question. Are there any geographical differences across, sorry, please.
I recently read about the prevalence in India in two southern centers. In Cochin, it is said to be around 3%, according to a study by Unnikrishnan et al. And there's also a study in Pondicherry, where it's said to be between 1 to 2%.
Right. So that leads on to the question, are there any geographical differences across the world as to the incidence of this subclinical hyperthyroidism, especially with the small multinodular goiter? Does iodine status actually impact on this condition as such?
Again, it's supposed to be more prevalent in iodine deficient areas rather than in areas of iodine sufficiency. That is the main thing. But other than that, the prevalence, I don't think there's any particular geographical preponderance.
So there could be more factors, but one of the important factors whenever it comes to thyroid is the iodine depleted region versus an iodine replete region. Obviously, that seems to have some correlation. As I said, when there is an iodine deficient region, the incidence of this mild multinodular goiter with the subclinical hyperthyroidism seems to be more. And how do we grade? I think sir earlier alluded to this, saying that TSH was less than 0.1 are the individuals who are more likely to progress to this persistent subclinical picture with clinical manifestations. So is there any particular grading system, or is there any particular grades which?
Grade one is the detectable value, that is between 0.3 to 0.1 is grade one. Grade two is undetectable.
Anything severe, that is less than 0.1. And what could be the symptoms, if at all, although we call this a subclinical, what could be the symptoms, if at all, in such patients who present with this?
That's what I was telling you, this is a misnomer. So most of some patient may come with tiredness, some may come with fatigue, some will come with the cardiovascular symptoms. In fact, coming to this case, because we are otherwise going away from the discussion of this case, elderly gentlemen, remember, in an elderly population, if somebody is coming to you with low atrial fibrillation, up to 10% of low atrial fibrillation may have subclinical hyperthyroidism. Somebody who is not in age and where bone density is disproportionately reduced as compared to other risk factor, one should keep an index of suspicion for this. Apathetic hyperthyroidism in elderly, classical symptoms and signs of hyperthyroidism are absent, and they have in fact depression, lethargy, and other features. In those cases, we should keep a high index of suspicion for subclinical hyperthyroidism. So in elderly, the presentation and symptomology is totally different as compared to normal people with hyperthyroidism. And as far as subclinical hyperthyroidism is concerned, they are vague, non-contributory, that will help you in picking up the right diagnosis. Another important point to remember, in elderly population, up to 10% of the patient, literature says up to 10% of the patient might not have any goiter. As you are telling, most of the cases are because of multinodular goiter, toxic adenoma, or Graves' disease. But elderly population is a particular population where on clinical examination, you may not find any goiter, still person might be having subclinical hyperthyroidism. So these are some variations in clinical symptomology and sign as compared to classical presentation in young age.
Okay, so that's a very important message, that we do not be just deceived by the fact that patients do not have the classical symptoms of thyrotoxicosis. Many of these symptoms could be subtle. Two important things he highlighted were, one, looking for the cardiovascular status of this person, and secondly, the risk of osteoporosis and fractures, because the bone and cardiovascular status often determine whether we need to treat a particular individual with this picture or not. So as we discussed earlier, this is the grading. When the TSH is 0.1 to 0.4, it's graded as 1. And the reason why we have this demarcation is important because both the complications due to subclinical hyperthyroidism and the progression depends on where they fall into, whether it's less than 0.1 or more than 0.1. So the clinical features could vary from symptoms of a mild thyroid hormone excess, like any other patients who would present, but often it is subtle, or it could be very non-specific. They can just present with an impaired quality of life, where the T4, T3 is still normal, but the TSH is low. The evidence behind cognitive dysfunction, there are some papers which suggest that there could be cognitive dysfunction with such a scenario or dementia, but the papers which looked at, studies which looked at treating these patients did not give any concrete evidence that it reverses the condition. So the evidence behind the cognitive dysfunction is still debatable, but what is clear is regarding the cardiovascular and the bone markers. So we discussed this earlier when the TSH can normalize spontaneously, and we saw that the grade 1 people, up to 30% of them can completely normalize the TSH, but what happens when the TSH is less than 0.1? Do they ever normalize?
They do also normalize, but again, the percentages are different. Again, with those who are suppressed TSH, we have to be more careful. Usually in this age group, it's more of multinodal goiter stands higher up the Graves' disease. And again, it could be an early warning of an evolving Graves' disease, or actually it is something it can be self-limiting over time. So the answer is yes, they can also normalize. So that's the exact reason. Initial clinical assessment to ensure, as Sarah said, sometimes they use the term subclinical thyrotoxicosis rather than subclinical hyperthyroidism, just to ensure we are comfortable that this patient is not exhibiting signs of hyperthyroidism clinically. So that is important to make an immediate decision. Sometimes we can just keep them on a beta blocker and reassess, treat them symptomatically. But with the suppressed TSH, they definitely need monitoring. But they can also normalize.
So what is the risk of progression in these individuals based on the grading, different grade?
Actually, normalization depends on two factors. Normalization, one, we have discussed, level of TSH, whether it is between 0.5 to 1 or less than 0.1, which is undetectable. And second, presence or absence of goiter. Somebody who is already having multinodular goiter, somebody who is having toxic adenoma, somebody who is having Graves' disease. And this we can ascertain either clinically by use of ultrasonography or by use of nuclear imaging. If in those subset of patients, it is unlikely that they will go into spontaneous remission. And it is other causes which you have highlighted, so many other causes. In those, more likely to go for spontaneous remission. So when we are deciding about spontaneous remission, wait and watch policy, we have to take into account both the severity of reduction as well as the underlying etiology, because that is going to decide whether it is transient one or it is a permanent one, or it is going to progress actually.
Yeah, obviously, trying to, it may be difficult to work out all the etiologies in all those elderly patients, but it's be good if we can make, so that we can make a better prediction of what is the possibility of it progressing. So in usual centers, maybe where they cannot afford an imaging, like a scan, maybe at least an antibody status if it's clinically indicated, or an ultrasound that can help in at least to predicting the progress.
So the message is, if we do not know a diagnosis, rather than putting them on a label or discharging them from the clinic, at least review them once more after some time, because new things could have been evolving while we are waiting for those 2 to 3 months time period. So other factors that predict the progression to overt hyperthyroidism, we discussed regarding the TSH levels and the presence or absence of goiter being the two important factors which will predict whether they will progress to an overt hyperthyroidism. Are there any other factors?
So mostly based on the etiology, depending upon the etiology, whether the patient may progression is there or not, whether it's iodine is a deficient patient, then you can replace the iodine, then the progression is going to be normal. The prognosis is going to be fair. But it's a overt hypothyroidism, then it's the natural history itself, most of the patient with the subclinical hypothyroidism around 30 to 40%. They can go as a overt hyperthyroidism. So if it is when you do a thyroid receptor antibodies, which can clearly say the patient may go for a overt hyperthyroidism, or a nuclear imaging can clearly help us whether the patient may go for a frank hyperthyroidism.
So the one other factor is the TSH receptor antibody. As you said, these are not the regular thyroid peroxidase antibody that we measure. The TSH receptor antibodies are more specific for Graves' disease. So people who have a high TSH receptor antibody with the subclinical hyperthyroidism also have a risk factor towards progressing into a frank thyrotoxic picture later on. But the question is regarding the iodine deficiency, which you said it's often difficult in a clinical scenario to check for iodine deficiency, do a 24-hour urinary iodine level, and how do we replace as such?
Before we got, because you have raised the issue of TSH receptor antibody, we have seen in institutes a lot of patients coming to us from outside. Please do not ask for TSH receptor antibody indiscriminately in patients of hyperthyroidism and subclinical hyperthyroidism. It is not available routinely, a very costly investigation, does not add much. There are only very select clinical scenarios where there is a definite role of measuring thyroid receptor antibodies. The easiest and the cheapest investigation which is available virtually in every smallest town of this country is ultrasonography with Doppler assessment, vascular Doppler of the thyroid gland. That will give you a good insight whether it is a Graves, whether it is multinodular, whether it is nodular toxic adenoma, whether it is transient thyroiditis. But so if there are no investigations available, the cheapest and easily available is ultrasonography after T3, T4, TSH. TSH receptor antibody should be used very judiciously, should not be used virtually in every patient. This is the message actually.
Another investigation which is quite useful in centers where nuclear medicine is available is doing a radioactive iodine uptake or a technetium scan. If the uptake is homogeneous and excessive, then it's more likely to progress. On the other hand, if the uptake is suppressed and it's low, then it's more likely a thyroiditis, which is mostly a self-limiting condition.
Okay, so that's a risk of progression from different studies which we can see and the facts regarding the TSH normalization. So risk factors predicting progression, often Graves' disease progresses more frequently than the multinodular goiter. Presence of iodine deficiency, we talked about the clinical difficulty of measuring the 24-hour urinary iodine level. In patients who are less than 65 years, where there is a grade 2 TSH rather than grade 1, and where there is an iodine deficiency, you supplement them with iodine or give big iodine load in an MNG patient, that can also elevate the T4, T3 levels. So what are the adverse sequelae or complications with untreated subclinical hyperthyroidism in the long term? So we touched upon this a little bit, the cardiovascular and the bone factors. Probably we can.
Of course, probably the main complications we are looking for are, number one, the one in the heart. There is a more chance of atrial fibrillation and heart failure. And of course, for the ladies, especially untreated subclinical thyrotoxicosis or hyperthyroidism is a risk factor to the bone. It can lead to more osteoporosis. Of course, there are some other controversial studies which are not given the last word, that the cognitive function, etc., are declining in these untreated patients. But we still do not know the right answer yet. As of now, we can say the effects on the heart and effects on bone are definitely predominant.
So the T4, T3 could be well at the upper limit of normal, technically within the normal range, but in an elderly, undiagnosed, undetected CAD could well be there. As a second insult, if there is also a subclinical hyperthyroidism, that can add on to increase these complications. As we said, a 2 to 3-fold increase in atrial fibrillation, increased risk of heart failure, CHD mortality increases by about, with a hazard ratio of 1.8 in patients who have a grade 2 TSH level, and if there is additional insult like osteoporosis and fractures. So finally, how to treat them and whom to treat them? Amongst these individuals who present to us with a suppressed TSH, who should we select and who should we be treating?
The current guidelines have a sort of cutoff of 65 years age based on that, above and below. And in whether in an elderly patient above 65 with the presence of risk factors for osteoporosis, cardiovascular disease, and women who are not osteoprotected with steroids, alendronate or estrogen, the overall concern is to treat. Whereas in most of the cases, there is more that it has to be an individualized decision whether to treat or not. So the clear-cut indications mainly stay within an elderly patient who have risk factors where there is a highest increased mortality on top of the cardiovascular and osteoporosis. These are the categories we definitely treat. All the others we have to decide on an individual basis. Just as a rough idea, and again I agree with the age cutoff, which might not really apply to our population. And with such a lot of thyroid patients in our base, we should really be formulating our own. Thank you.
Actually, he has rightly pointed out what is your TSH and what is your age. And the next two things is bone and cardiovascular system. So if you have a TSH which is less than 0.1, I think we have to treat elderly individual more than 65 with a TSH of less than 0.1, you have to treat. How to treat? Treatment modalities are same. Surgery, radioiodine ablation, and medical therapy. It depends on what is an underlying etiology. You have to choose according to that, whether that modality is available at your place or not, whether the patient is willing for that or not. So there are many, many variables based on which you have to use one out of three. If TSH is between 0.1 to 0.5, then we have to decide what to do. And then we have to risk evaluate the patient. If patient is less than 65 years of age, patient is asymptomatic, patient does not have underlying cardiac disease, patient has normal bone density, they can be followed up. There is no need to treat. But if they are more than 65 years of age and they have cardiovascular disease or decreased bone mineral density, they have to treat. If cardiovascular disease, bone mineral densities are not there, but they have a history suggestive of clinical symptoms and signs suggestive of hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis, and still we have to consider them for treat. So these are the many variables which we have to consider apart from the grading, severity. That's how we are going to decide. So it's not a simple straightforward. What modalities? They are same. Surgery, radioiodine and drugs, which we have to choose accordingly in three different patients as we are doing in young age.
So we do have other things to go through with regards to the discussion, but I think we are running out of time. For that reason, maybe we'll just take one or two questions very briefly, and then we'll end the session.
Actually, with this case scenario where you're not given the history and the physical examination, if a case comes like this in the day-to-day practice, we first ask for whether the patient had taken thyroxine or not. So that's the first question that you're going to ask. The next problem is some of these patients who were thyrotoxic had a radioiodine ablation, and subsequently on a follow-up, they'll have a normal T3, normal T4, and a suppressed TSH. So these two important conditions in our day-to-day practice we come across.
Thank you, sir. Any other comments or questions? If not,
I think following up weight in these patients is very important. Periodic weight. You know, if you have a patient who has got a suppressed TSH, normal thyroid function, you are in doubt. You ask the patient to weigh himself on a monthly basis, and if a patient is continuing to lose weight, I think that's a very clear indication that you are dealing with thyrotoxicosis that is persisting. If there is no other cause for weight loss, that might be an indication for initiating treatment.
So there's no hard evidence as such, we go by only the weight, but as in with any other endocrine condition, if there is two or three factors put together, because most of the endocrine conditions do have a non-specific presentation, when two or three factors put together is pointing towards a disease-causing problem, then we go ahead with treatment. I think we conclude the session there.
Thank you. Thank you. That was an excellent session. We'll give a big hand to the moderator and the panelists. I invite Dr. N.K. Narayanan to hand over the mementos to Dr. Rajesh Rajput. Dr. N.K. Narayanan, also please hand over the mementos to Dr. Arun Kannan and Dr. Satyan Raghavan. Thank you, sir. I invite Dr. Sridhar to hand over memento to Dr. N.K. Narayanan.